are reduced.
So reduction of ROS, because I would, you know, I guess some of Richard Veach's have put some ideas out there about the
ketones direct effect. Yeah,
about, because it's so funny, because in my mind I always think about, like, well, if you're inducing your mitochondria to work more, you're going to make more reactive mm-hmm. oxygen species, right? And that's sort of what I think would be a driver of killing abnormal cells, cancer cells that are primed to die. They're they're expressing way more pre-apoptotic proteins.
Yeah.
But, you know, they've countered it with anti-apoptotics. All they need is a little push, a little reactive oxygen species push to death.
And that's increased initially.
It is, okay.
So, yeah, it actually activates, like, NRF2 and stuff. So when someone gets on a ketogenic diet, it's a stress to the body.
Yeah, so you are making more, because if you're causing your mitochondria to only work, right, that's the only way you can make energy, then you think that you have to be making reactive oxygen species.
Yep.
At least if you're looking in the context of a cancer cell, which would be glycolytic and not using their mitochondria at all, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Then definitely there would be a much more of an increase in ROS. So you're saying that it can suppress ROS. Is that through some of what Richard Veach has put out there in the semi-ubiquinone, how it's like
oxidized Q makes it less available.
Because that's the most.
If Q is oxidized, So
Q being ubiquinone.
Yeah, ubiquinone. If ubiquinone is oxidized, which is achieved with R beta hydroxybutyrate metabolism, if that's oxidized, then you have less availability for that electron to react with molecular oxygen in the metabolic pathway.
Right.
So you would produce less superoxide anion, which is your precursor to more reactive oxygen species. And that's been shown elegantly in a number of models, including the cardiac model, which he did, the Langenhorn model, the perfused heart preparation, showing that you get a greater hydraulic efficiency of the heart in the presence of ketones. With a given amount of oxygen, you can generate proportionally more ATP, energy currency.
Yeah. Is there another way that ketones also suppress ROS? Or is that through the
acutely
effect of activating mitochondria and then increasing NRF2 and things like that?
Yeah, that would be a secondary effect. I would say from an acute point of view, as simply as a metabolic fuel, the mitochondrial efficiency is greater. So you will have a greater mitochondrial membrane potential, a greater driving force for ATP synthase to make ATP. So it energizes the mitochondria in a way that would be expected from a metabolic fuel that's sort of superior from a bioenergetic point of view. So you have a greater capacity to generate ATP for a given amount of oxygen that's available.
Right.
So with that occurring, the metabolic efficiency of the cell would be sort of preserved. You're using less oxygen to make the same amount of ATP, less reactive oxygen species. And of course, if you're shifting away from glycolysis and shifting more towards oxidative phosphorylation.
So in the context of a cancer cell.
In the context of, any kind of cell, like your tissue, really, skeletal muscle or cancer cell. Yeah, you are forcing the body in a way, and it's a stress initially, to upregulate mitochondrial machinery, really, and more mitochondria. Mitochondria will start, budding off and creating mitochondrial biogenesis. Yeah, the number of mitochondria, the proteins that are associated with the electron transport chain.
That's
proteins are upregulated. So you make more of these proteins.
Yeah. Yeah, it acts very similar to lactate. I don't know if you're familiar with any of the brain work and George Brooks lactate.
Very interested in lactate as a graduate
student. Yeah,
because
it does the same
thing. Yeah,
goes to the same transporter, right?
Yeah, MCT.
Yeah.
I studied lactate as sort of an undergrad and graduate student, like I am studying ketones now as an alternative fuel.
Were you looking at it in the brain?
Yeah, during hypoxia. So I studied the neural control of autonomic regulation, so brain hypoxia and what our brains do under hypoxia.
Yeah.
And lactate is a big player in preserving, brain function, viability, health. And I studied lactate as an alternative energy source under hypoxia. And now I think of ketones as like the alternative energy source, when your brain is under normal physiology. And I think there's some uses for lactate too as a fuel. I think when we exercise, we're creating lactate and we feel good. It's not really talked about. It's something that I want to study and maybe talk about a little bit more, is that lactate, you're also sending, not only are you sending ketones to your brain, but you're sending lactate to your brain.
Yeah.
And I think that's maybe not talked about that much, but there's potential out there for lactate supplements.
Yeah, George Brooks, UC Berkeley, he's, I don't know if you're familiar with any of his work.
A little bit.
He pioneered the whole lactate shuttle theory, but he's been looking at the effects of, you know, lactate generated during exercise, for example, when you're forcing your muscle cells to work harder and you're making more lactate. It gets over, crosses over the blood-brain barrier,
easily.
You know, gets into neurons. So neurons themselves actually use lactate generated from astrocytes. Mm-hmm. So they're using neurons are actually using lactate. It's also thermodynamically and energetically favorable source of energy, much like ketones.
Yep.
And so neurons like doing that because, one, it's easier, and two, because glucose can then be freed up to be, you know, shunted in the pentose phosphate pathway, which can be used to generate NADPH, which is, you know, important for glutathione recycling,
capacity,
which makes sense. Well, it probably, I think there's a lot of parallels between, you know, ketone bodies and ketone supplements and how they're not only being used as a preferential source of energy in the brain. Do you know anything about this? About like how it frees up glucose then to be used for other metabolic pathways? Yeah, glucose sparing.
Yeah, it's thought that some of the work by Stephen Kunane, I think, is shedding light on this too. If you,
where's he at?
He's in Canada. Get the institute that he's at. Joe LaManna has done some similar work, and he's at Case Western, and looked at the kind of the interaction of what does the brain prefer as what's the preferred fuel source for the brain. I get this question a lot. I think it depends on, you know, I don't know if it's right to say that the brain always prefers
the brain
ketones.
Cell we're talking about.
Yeah,
one.
The brain. Yeah,
neurons
and astrocytes. But yeah, I guess. I mean, maybe we're definitely biased towards understanding neurons relative to astrocytes.
I think most people ask you that question.
Astrocytes are fascinating. I think we need to study that more. But I think in the context of like aging, in the context of traumatic brain injury or pathology, I think the brain will really prefer to use ketones because, or in the context of some kind of stress, you know, hypoglycemia or something like that, I think the brain will also prefer to use ketones.
Yeah.